Truckers held a protest in Metro Manila to express their opposition to the NLEX toll hike. Karen De Guzman filed this report.
More than 100 trucks gathered around Andes Circle along Bonifacio Drive in Manila opposed the increase in toll rates on North Luzon Expressway. According to the truckers group, the toll hike is unjustifiable and unfair to motorists given the worsening conditions along the roadway. They also lament the timing of the toll hike, which is said to be unsuitable to the government's directives of reducing logistics costs since it will add to the burdens of the public in dealing with inflation. The toll hike came into effect last June 15, and the group has submitted their opposition letter to the Toll Regulatory Board. The convoy of about 200 truck drivers has caused major traffic delays from Andes Circle to Manila North Harbor. Policemen and traffic enforcers were deployed to assist in the traffic and to ensure peace and order during the protest. Now the convoy is heading to Zaragoza Street in Tondo, Manila, and the caravan will continue until 11 in the morning. Within the NLEX open system, which covers Balintawak, Mindanao Avenue, Caruhatan, Valenzuela, and Megawayan, and Marilao in Bulacan, the toll has increased by 7 pesos for Class 1 vehicles, 17 pesos for Class 2 vehicles, and 19 pesos for Class 3 vehicles. This raises the toll to 69 pesos for regular cars and sports utility vehicles, 172 for buses and small trucks, and 206 pesos for large trucks. While within the NLEX closed system, from Bukawin, Bulacan to Santa Ines in Mabalacat City, Pampanga, the toll has increased by 26 pesos for Class 1, 65 pesos for Class 2, and 77 pesos for Class 3. At Subic Tipo, they have to pay an additional 4 pesos for Class 1, 8 pesos for Class 2, and 11 pesos for Class 3. According to the group, they will continue this protest until they will hear a response from the government.
Passengers of the LRT1 now enjoying its more modern trains that were launched Thursday, with management promising to give their customers a more comfortable ride. More from Jackie Manaba.
One of the train sets purchased from Spain in 2017 has started running on the revenue line on Thursday on Metro Manila's oldest urban railway, the LRT1. Passengers instantly noticed better air conditioning inside the train compared to the older units.
Sa aircon, mayroon yung luma, yung luma. Kasi ngayon wala na eh. Masarap sakyan ngayon. Malamig.
Naranasan ko talaga na mahabang pila, na nagkasiksikan sa loob ng train, pero okay lang naman.
According to the Light Rail Manila Corporation, the private company which maintains and operates the LRT Line 1, it's not your usual air conditioning equipment.
The temperature inside the train adjusts to the volume of people inside. So may parang automatic yung kanyang sensor that detects, adjusts to the crowd volume. I can say na mas modern yung systems.
The new train also has a space for PWDs, signaling system that allows for smoother ride, and a high-tech console that allows the driver to immediately determine the cause of any glitches. The first batch of the same train sets, or the fourth generation units, delivered to Manila in 2021, had problems with water leaking from air conditioning units. It also gets worse when it rains. The Department of Transportation admitted the issue early this year, but the operator assured the public that the Spain-made train set and the additional units coming in the next few weeks will have no water leaks, as these have gone through rigorous tests.
Ongoing yung fixes, no, to address the water leak issue. The trains are being repaired in batches, no, dahil natapos na yung first batch, kaya ngayon ay nagamit na namin yung isang train, and then actually in August, first week noon, may madadagdag kami na isa pang train. So ito po ay gradually being repaired para maka-deploy kami unti-unti.
More passengers can look forward to a more comfortable riding experience. The same trains will also be used for the LRT1 Cavite Extension project in the future. The LRMC also says they will not retire all of the Belgium-made Generation 1 trains, which have been running for the past 4 decades. The company says 48 trains will still be used to temporarily augment existing trains amid the expected doubling of passenger volume upon the completion of the LRT Line 1 extension from Baclaran down to Bacoor, Cavite. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
The government is being urged to hike the salaries of teachers and school personnel. Ara Perez joins us with that story. Ara, go ahead.
Finally, the Alliance of Concerned Teachers Philippines is pushing for a 50,000 peso entry-level salary for teachers from the current 27,000 pesos. Act Secretary General Raymond Basilio explained it is only proper to match their salary with those of professionals and most importantly with the family living wage. Basilio said they will use the salary hike for their professional development programs and postgraduate studies along with other expenses for their teaching duties. Dr. Jonathan Geronimo, Secretary General of ACT Private Schools, also wants Congress to pass a legislation which will match the salaries of private and public school teachers. Non-teaching personnel, meanwhile, are also asking for a 33,000 peso entry-level salary from the current 11,000 pesos. ACT Chairperson Vladimir Quetua believes it's only a matter of political will and prioritization for the Marcos administration to fulfill this for teachers and the education sector. On his first year in office and amid the upcoming SONA, teachers believe President Marcos needs remediation, not a pass or failure, but a chance to implement salary increase for teachers, more benefits, and respect for their right to unions. Stanley.
All right, thank you so much for the update, Ara Perez. While economic recovery and poverty alleviation remain the Marcos administration's top priority, priority measures meant to address these issues have yet to hurdle the Congress and Senate. RG Cruz with a special report.
This is Norma Abacan. She's on her way to a local fishmonger to get their meal for the day. She's going to split her purchase with her husband, a freelance driver. They live just steps away from the seat of the country's House of Representatives, where President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is set to deliver his second State of the Nation address. Norma sells beauty products to augment her husband's income so they can cope with inflation.
Sa ngayon, racket, direct selling. Hindi po nag-aalok.
Nag-aalok?
Apo.
Apo,
parang personal collection. Mas po, yung bigas po. Tsaka yung isda, lahat naman po tumaas, kaya lang sana mapababa.
Controlling inflation remains the top national concern of a majority of Filipinos according to Pulse Asia's latest survey. It's also the one issue where the respondents said the Marcos administration fared most poorly.
Doon sa increase ng paid ng workers, doon sa dalawa pang usapin, lalo na yung pinakamahalaga, yung mataas na presyo ng bilihin, hati ang Pilipino, one-third ang approving, one-third ang undecided, at higit sa one-third ang disapproving. So ibig sabihin, karamihan ng mga Pilipino ay parang hindi sila nasisiyahan doon sa aprobado, doon sa pagtugon ng administrasyon sa dalawang usapin na ito, kahirapan at mataas na presyo ng bilihin.
Senate President Miguel Zubiri says the economy and uplifting the lives of the impoverished remain the priorities of the administration, as seen in the 20 priority bills targeted for enactment by both the House and the Senate by year-end. Most of the bills have already hurdled the House but are languishing in the Senate.
It's almost about 44 measures. Pero yung pinangako namin na may pasa namin hopefully by December of 2023 is about 20. Sayang momentum natin. This year, 2022 to 2023, we're looking at 6.5 growth, GDP growth rate. Ang gusto po natin Pangulo by middle of his term, by 2025, baka makaabot na tayo ng 8% growth rate, which I think is phenomenal. So, phenomenal sa buong region. Talaga magaling yan.
Before the 19th Congress adjourned its first regular session last June, only six out of the then 42 priority bills got the nod of the country's bicameral legislature. The Senate chief believes most of his colleagues will vote for the unfinished priorities.
The mandatory ROTC, kasi meron din from the majority na ayaw. But the others, I presume that they are happy bills. Even the MUP, yung ating pension ng ating mga sundalo at kapulisan, maduguyan. I feel that within the Senate itself, we can get the majority support of that. Kasi long-term, pag tinignan mo yung long-term situation, lalong lalala ang ating fiscal position pag hindi po natin actionan yan. Dahil as of today, yung buwis, binabayaran mong buwis, binabayaran kong buwis at lahat ng mga kababayan natin, yun pong ginagamit natin para sa pensyon ng sundalo at kapulisan. May mga madugo pero sa tingin ko papasa din.
Senate President Pro Tempore Loren Legarda, however, explains the process won't be simple and it will depend on many factors.
Legislating any measure is a complex, arduous process that involves consultations, negotiations, sometimes even compromises. The extent to which these bills will be easy or difficult to enact will depend on many factors, like the level of support and cooperation from not just the Senate, but both chambers of Congress, even the alignment of interests and advocacies among lawmakers and the overall political climate.
A protracted debate is also inevitable.
Differing opinions and finding a common ground is essential in advancing the president's agenda and achieving meaningful results.
A political expert, however, says beyond working on unfinished priorities, the administration must also zero in on making sure the country's national budget is properly spent, as this is key to making sure all programs are implemented well.
Sabi na rin yan, pero I would argue na kailangan ng more effective governance mechanisms. Aside from the budget modernization, hindi natututukan yung performance. Kailangan ding palakasin yung congressional oversight during budget implementation. After all, sila yung nag-approve ng budget. Having said that, baka kailangan ring magkaroon ng congressional voice at the very start of the budget process.
Dr. Magno also says the public must have a greater voice in crafting the budget and the government must employ new and emerging technologies such as artificial intelligence to improve the delivery of government services. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.